Hello, and welcome to the Romanesque lecture. There are going to be some walls of text. They are there for a very important reason. They are important, and they're worth remembering and understanding. Romanesque means like the Romans. Throughout the last couple of chapters, we've seen the lasting influence of the Romans, which partially is to their credit or partially to the Greeks. What we need to understand here is the growing power and influence of the church. With an increased population, increased number of worshipers, comes an increased amount of money that the church has for spending. Throughout the rest of Europe, other things are happening. Arabs being expelled from Sicily, manorial estates, feudalism becoming more a fact of life, military and political equilibrium. I'm not just reading these things, I need you to understand that these things are influencing art and life and influencing choices in how and what art is made. Now, to understand what Romanesque is, in a quick kind of blurb, simply look at this. Thick walls, stone vaults, exterior relief sculpture, and round arches. That is what Romans focused on in their architecture. Now, the pilgrimage road. Pilgrimages are these holy journeys, typically to important holy cities like Jerusalem or Rome. Jerusalem, being so far away from Europe, France in particular, is incredibly far. It's also incredibly dangerous and incredibly expensive. Rome, a bit closer, a bit safer, a little on the cheaper side. And then there's a third choice, Santiago de Compostela. Safer and shorter. Also, very comfortable because this was the economy pilgrimage. It was more heavily relied upon by pilgrims. Now, the question is, why go on a pilgrimage? What's it for? Why is it worth all the trouble? What brings you closer by just going to a holy city? Does that instantly mean you get to go into heaven? Does that instantly mean that you are more religious than your neighbor? Does that mean you don't have to give more to the church? Well, some would say that going to a holy city and walking in the same footsteps as your prophet, as your Messiah, can make you feel closer to your faith. It could validate, if you would, it could validate your belief in that faith to walk in the same streets or to see the same landscape that the people that you've worshipped have seen. So that's one way a person may think about the pilgrimages. What you need to understand is the basic facts. By car, at 60 miles an hour, roughly, we're looking at 15 hours. Over marshes, over rough terrain, and most of all, the Pyrenees Mountains, which serve as a border between Spain and France. This is not an easy trek in the least. So try to imagine how that might be walking the entire way, which is what this is typically called, the way. Also, a movie made in 2011 by Emilio Estevez starring Charlie Sheen. The way, this route, is still walked today by pilgrims, by tourists, by people looking for something more in their life, or people looking for a unique tour of Europe. Now, getting back to the idea of money, think about it. All these pilgrims are walking to the same place. What do those pilgrims need? They need food, they need lodging, they need protection, and of course they're going to want to stop and worship somewhere. Enter the pilgrimage church. One of the big advancements that helped the Christian church is the refinement of vaults. Now, the barrel and the tunnel vault, of course, is very practical, but a new type of vault involving a pointed arch is going to introduce a new vocabulary to the cathedral and the churches that we have known so far. The earliest of these pilgrimage churches is Saint Foy, named after Saint Faith. This church had stone vaults. It had a stone ceiling. That stone ceiling, of course, afforded better acoustics and was much more fireproof than a church or a cathedral with a wooden ceiling, coffered or no. And I'm not trying to, it might seem strange to make this connection, but think about it. This is a church that's very similar to a truck stop or a rest stop. Think about it. What do you do at a truck stop? You gas up, use the bathroom, you know, take in some sights or check out something interesting, and then you move on. Well, if you look at the design of this church, think about the function and the form. You have very much a church that's meant to handle a high capacity of visitors, in that the aisles are extra wide around the nave. You have a clear area, probably for the locals in the nave. You have extra large aisles and then a radiating chapel, an ambulatory around the apse. So someone comes in, they, you know, they sprinkle their hands with holy water or something. They look up at the front, and that's not the Umbrella Corporation. That is the crossing, the heart of the body of the cruciform church. They come in, they walk along the aisles, they see some relics, they see some beautiful pictures, they say a prayer, and then they walk out and move on along their pilgrimage way. That's, in essence, what's happening there. You have the choir, you have a priest giving a sermon, singing this beautiful music, and because of the stone vaults, it becomes this otherworldly, incredible experience. Now, when looking at this picture, where is the tribune? The tribune, of course, is on the second floor. I wanted you to see this in context so you could better appreciate the size of this space. Those are the benches. There's the altar, one of the altars, and of course the crossing. It is a massive space, and one can feel incredibly small before those arches and those other features. Now, if we move outside, we can look at the program and the door. The door is a highly complex subject, which is made up of six parts. Obviously, the doors, the trumeau, the tympanum, and the lintel, as well as the arch over it. But the arch here, on the whole, is called the archivolts. Now, you have the voussoir, and you have the keystone and the springing, but we're not worried so much about keystone, springing, and voussoir. We want to be concerned with archivolts, because that's a new vocabulary term. And while it might seem obvious that door jams are door jams served vital purposes in educating and decorating church entryways, church portals. So, when we look at the picture on the left, we can see incredible decorations on it, which we will go into in some detail coming up. Saint Foy served as the housing, as the church which kept the reliquary of Saint Foy. Now, what is a reliquary? What is a relic? Well, a relic could be any number of things. It could be an item that is of extreme holy value, or it could be a body, it could be a piece of a body. But why go through the trouble of visiting a church that has the toe of St. Paul? Or a church that contains a bit of a saint that was beheaded or burned at the stake? Well, for the simple reason that by seeing these things, you are made closer to your faith. By seeing these things, you can say, wow, they really existed. I saw it, and therefore you can feel closer to your faith. When we look at Saint Foy, or Saint Foy, however you want to pronounce it, we can see some extreme differences, or very clear differences, in their tympanums. And this message is really one that's been communicated for a couple of thousand years now. Under God's power, let's look at this in more detail here. Where are you? I know I've got it. Oh, wait. There we go. So, we have order. We have beauty, we have arches, and the arches of the building serve to symbolize as halos for the saints. Very clever. And the messages of the Lord serve as a roof or a gable above these people, protecting them. Christ's right hand, raised in benediction, seems to bless the people on his right hand. And in the Christian language of images, the most important person beside Christ would always be on his right hand, on his right side, and the second most important person would be on his left. And typically, when Christ is raising one hand, he will have the other lowered in condemnation or damnation. He sometimes might have all of his hand open, as he does here. He sometimes might have his first two fingers up and the other two behind his thumb in a sign of benediction, slightly curved. We will see that coming up and of course, in later chapters. So on the left side, you have order, you have beauty, you have repetition, you have symmetry. On the other side, you have chaos, asymmetry, confusion, and pain. Those that are damned are left to chaos, whereas those that are saved can find safety, beauty, and everything else. It's a rather simple message, and we first saw a message like that in the chapter on the ancient Near East, in the stele of, tell me if you can remember it, Naram Sin. Naram Sin stood proud before the people he was conquering, and then those behind him were in clear order, symmetrical, regimented, or regimental-like. The same thing is being shown here, as Christ, above all others, the largest, the tallest, and bringing order before him. Moving on, we can then compare that with the tympanum at Autun. Capitals carved into stories, so every part of the exterior now is not just a plain facade, but a chance, an opportunity to decorate, illustrate, and educate in the faith. Looking up close, we see another interesting story. Here, Christ's hands are even, and while it was in the other tympanum, we can see now clearly a second halo around Christ. Whereas typically, Christ has a halo around his head, here he has a large halo around his body, as if to set him apart from man and demon and angel. This large full-body halo is often referred to as a mandorla, and it comes from the far, far east. Again, Christianity, or a faith, or a culture, drawing upon a far-flung people. On the left, you see not so much symmetry, but an order of sorts, a safety, under the arches of the church, and on the other side, you see pain. Whereas, it's telling a story about faith. Those that have patience, actually we'll zoom in, those that have faith have something more than those that don't. Those that have patience and have all of these seven virtues have something more than those that don't. Therefore, those that don't have faith have less. Therefore, those that are faithful are heavier, and those that are not faithful are weightless. And so here, the souls of those before heaven and hell are weighed. And you can see here a demon trying to cheat, and trying to pull it down, but is lifted up by the weight of the penitent, of the faithful worshiper. These are not nice demons. These are wild, they are in high relief, and they are incredibly kind of creepy looking. And think back to what I was talking about before with techniques that were lost. Even now, these incredibly crude sculptures harken back to that archaic style of Greek sculpture, where lines alone would try to communicate the simple details in a piece of fabric. Whereas before in Greece in the Hellenistic or classical period, or in Rome, you would have sumptuous flowing robes. Here you have again a crude pattern of lines to imply folds of cloth. Now, to look at this in modern light, it actually looks even creepier. I just wanted you to see it up close so you could better appreciate just what all went into this and see as well just how deep and how high relief some of these parts are. So as the sun rises and sinks over the facade, it will create shifting shadows and an even more creepy story being told. And here we have the entire portal. You have people to the side to give you a sense of scale. And even before you enter the cathedral, before you enter this religious space, you are made to feel small by the scale of the doors. Remember that people were slightly shorter, and the average height was probably, for men, somewhere around, 5'7", 5'5"? Maybe shorter? Which would put their heads right around the doorknobs. Right about there. So these massive doors, which of course would allude to the gates of heaven or hell, Christ in judgment standing or sitting before you, and the majesty overlooking you as you enter. It would set someone in their place. Now, one of the things that you might find in here is a reliquary, and this particular reliquary is of significant importance, for it contains one of the most incredible relics. The Stavelot reliquary contains pieces, or claims to contain, pieces of the true cross. Now, not only is it important because of its contents, its presentation as a triptych. A triptych is a three-piece work of art. The three pieces are all presented together as a single work. On the left side, you have the connection of Constantine and Rome with the church. And on the right side, you have Helena. And Helena, Constantine's wife, sought to find the original cross. Here, she hears tale of it, she searches for it, and she finds the true cross. So you have Jerusalem and Rome united with elements of the true cross. The true cross being the cross that Christ was crucified on. Now, I don't know about you guys, but the mad scientist in me, the guy that loves science fiction and all that kind of stuff, really wants to pull a Jurassic Park and see if we can get some blood off of that and maybe, you know, clone just to see what would happen. I don't mean to offend anyone, I just think that would be an incredible idea and just, I want to try that. Moving on, though, we have more manuscripts. Flattened space, more an emphasis on bold designs and not so much the traceries and the finesse that we saw in the Hiberno-Saxon period. Monastic scriptoria are in full swing and Bibles are being made by the dozen. Well, more than the dozen, I'm using that phrase as an expression. What's interesting to note, though, is how the development of Christ, how the development of figures is kind of being rebuilt. Whereas before we had much more finesse and detail and shading, we're kind of starting over. And one of the things I want to point out to you is another facet of Christian symbolic language, and that is Christ the grown man sitting in the Mother Mary's lap. Now, typically, when we think of a grown man sitting in a woman's lap, we think that something's a little strange and perhaps some money's being involved and someone getting a spanking. But that's not the case at all. There's nothing perverted or strange about this. There is a reason this child man or man-child is sitting in the Mother Mary's lap. What is it called and why is it called that? Well, Christ, when presented like this, is referred to as a homunculus. And the reason child appears as a man is because while he is a child of God and while Mary is the mother, he is shown here as a full-grown man because it alludes to his destiny as Savior. That is the reason Christ is displayed as a child man or man-child. a homunculus, worth remembering. Again, having nothing to do with Full Metal Alchemist. Now, probably one of my favorite pieces of art of all time is this piece, the Bayeux Tapestry. At some point during the semester, I'm going to bring in my copy of it. I have a copy to scale of this piece. It's over 230 feet long, the original. Mine is about 35, 40 feet long. And we can fit it in the classroom. You can look at the whole thing. You can look at all the unique people, the unique animals, the unique boats, the unique bits of armor and crests and words and names. The Bayeux Tapestry is not a tapestry at all. It is, in fact, a piece of embroidery. This entire thing itself is an act of devotion. Now, while this work is secular, it has nothing to do with God, it is an incredible act of devotion. Think about it. While the men are away killing and being killed, hacking and being hacked, who's making this? The same people that birthed them, that raised them, that grew up with them. Mothers, sisters, wives, daughters, all worked together. It was not just one woman, but many different women. Weaved a tale, or rather embroidered a tale, of the Battle of Normandy. And you can see clear words telling, and in my copy you can see a translation of what different parts say, what they mean. You can see unique animals. You can see crests and colors unique to very particular families. Different types of armor, whether it's scale or leather or rings. A true act of devotion. Now, in the Romanesque period, we've looked at Romanesque influence. We looked at several different things. If I may suggest you copy something down, it would be these two paragraphs that really sum up the chapter. On the right column, you're going to see important words that are worth remembering, definitely. Cluster pier, compound pier. You'll see an example of that. Let's see, right here, you have a... Well, not there, sorry. We're going to see it more easily in the Gothic period, so I think we'll focus on it there. Compound pier, clustered pier, definitely need to know. Crossing, you need to know. Mandorla, you need to know. Program. Radiating chapels, definitely, and reliquary. Tribune, not so vital. Tympanum, definitely. And rib, it's worth remembering. As always, I'd like to remind you that you can always, you can always stop by my office and have me review the chapter with you. I will walk you through it step by step. If you want, you can always take the online quiz from the book. I think it's extremely helpful, and I think you might find it that way as well. If you have questions, you can email me, you can leave a voicemail on my office phone, or you can talk with your friends about it. Either way, I hope you enjoyed it, and I look forward to seeing you in class. Good luck on your tests, and I'll either see you in the next video or in our next lecture. Thanks.